Let's go ahead and get started. I am Derek Law, an online education. So we are going to be talking about developing quality videos for effective learning. This can be as formal or informal as you want. So I would appreciate it if you guys want to mention any tips that you guys have as well. I'm okay with that, or I can always just ramble and talk, ask my wife. They don't shut up. So, but feel free to jump in at any time if you guys have your, if you want to interject on this as well, because I know most of you are probably using videos as well in your courses, and we're all kind of experts here. So, what we are going to be talking about, yes, developing quality videos for effective learning. This is not just for online classes. I think the description of this was specifically for online classes. Maybe, I don't know, but this is more about for face-to-face, for online courses, for hybrids, for anything. You can utilize videos in classroom. So this is a broader approach than just for your online classes. Okay, let me make sure. So what we are going to be focusing on mainly is connections and digging deeper. You are creating and utilizing video for student engagement and learning. Connections and digging deeper. That's going to be the main point of the videos, having you connect with your students, put a little more you into the courses, and giving you time to focus on kind of the good stuff, as I like to call it. And that's a digging deeper. I wonder if I have a...
Jesse, do you know if this room has a clicker?
It does not.
Okay, that's all right. I get my steps in.
It wasn't good enough for a clicker.
It wasn't good enough for a clicker.
So this is what we're going to cover today. Why are you here? And what will we cover? Why are you here? It's a big question. But specifically, why are you here for videos? We're going to cover why using videos in the classroom. That's going to be kind of the first part. This is kind of hard to break into parts, so they kind of all bleed together a little bit. After that, we're going to cover what makes for a quality video, and of course, why do some look better than others, why do some approaches work, is it a one-size-fits-all, are you going to put me in a box, Derek? No, but what makes them better than others? And then the last part, okay, so where do I start? That'll be a little bit more on the technical side, but this is not going to be a technical discussion on creating videos, production, editing, posts, whatever. This is going to focus more on the content and the design of the videos. But we'll talk a little bit about some software choices at the end. This is primarily going to be more of how to approach videos. Okay, so... Sorry, I just created the outline. I want to make sure I don't... miss anything. So I want to start with a video. So Michael Wesch, we're not going to watch the whole video of this. This is pretty popular. Some of you may have seen this video. So Michael Wesch is, he's a K-State. He's, anybody knows him? I think he's anthropology, I think. But he also is a huge, huge figure in college education, kind of in pedagogy. I've gone to conferences where he's at. He's an amazing speaker. And he talks about videos a lot, and I want to show you just a small clip from him where he talks about why videos are important. I didn't do a sound check in here. Let me make sure.
There are five reasons to get on camera and put a video into your course. Number one, because it puts more you and your units into your class, and you matter more than anything. As Karen Costa says in 99 Tips for Creating Simple and Sustainable Educational Videos, more than content, more than course design, you are the factor in an online course that has the greatest potential to help your students succeed. So greet your students at the virtual door with a welcome video.
I thought it'd be cool if we all just uploaded a video to start things off.
Share something about yourself.
I love to run, but I would like to add, I also love to run with my kids.
And ask them to do the same.
You can just grab your phone like this, just list these three things that you love to do.
Number two, it helps build relationships.
Hello, welcome to the class.
As the videos came in, I didn't care if they had bad lighting or stumbled over the words now and then.
Read my relationship recently got a cat.
I am a 24th year senior.
I really like to eat, but that's not really interesting.
I wasn't just talking to a camera anymore. I was talking to real people. Love the introductions you guys posted. We have so many different perspectives and talents. Number three, Use videos to validate and motivate students. Did you guys see Sarah's post on this? Mention great comments. Celebrate great work.
You guys might have seen Taylor have a really interesting experience.
Offer quick words of encouragement.
Hey guys, I know this week was super hard. The good news is I love to help people. If you need some help, just reach out to number four. It'll save you time.
A simple weekly overview video of big points and videos that clarify assignment expectations allow students to get onto the questions that really matter. And you can also make short explainer videos that answer any frequently asked questions about particular concepts or ideas. Number five, implicit messaging. Video is a great way to get across the most important lessons in the class, the lessons that are shown.
You're just hanging out with people just like you. You can't grow, you can't stretch yourself.
I just want to show you guys you can work it into your life, that you can work learning it.
So that was just part of a clip of his of a longer one that he does. But he, Michael Wesch, and again, if you want to look into him, that's
W-E-S-C-H, Michael Wesch. Yeah, he's a K-State, and if you ever get the opportunity to go to a conference where he's like the keynote, oh man, it is very inspiring. I got a little crush on him, I guess. I'm just like, man, it really just, he's very motivating as an educator. We're going to go on to this. This is kind of a summary of some other topics, but what Michael talked about was his first point was you puts more you into the classroom. Videos put you into the classroom, and I love that. That goes back to that connections. Putting you into the classroom, and I always say, if you're teaching a class online and there's no you, there's no presence, like what have we kind of reduced ourselves to if the course doesn't feel like there's an actual instructor, it's just kind of teaching itself, but if students feel like you're in the course, there's those connections, and humans, we love connections, and it's not surprising that when students feel connected to the instructor and to each other, that we have better retention rates. So I think, to me, I love he put that as point one, building connections as part of my point one. He talked about it builds relationships. It uses videos to validate and motivate students. And he mentioned saves time. In my summary, I've kind of taken his and I've added a few more from the research I've done. One of the biggest reasons why should I use video? It helps build the connection. Students build stronger connection to you, of course, the other students. Humans are communal. That's a big one. That's a really big one. That's a big discussion right now, right? With remote work and employees. Humans are communal. We are. We want to feel like we're a part of something. And it's not surprising that engagement and community is linked to higher retention. When you, I don't know if it's just you feel like you can slip under the radar and withdraw from the class, then you feel like you can just do that a little easier. But if you feel like you're part of the community, you're a part of something, you're more likely to just push through. You're more likely to not let your instructor down. And videos do that for your classes. Freeze up your time so you and your class can dig deeper into topics instead of repeating the same lecture every session, every class, every semester, every year. For those of you that just got in here, I was, when I opened up this, I talked about this is not just for online classes. This is also for face-to-face classes and hybrids. And so number two fits really well in that face-to-face model where you can have your students watch the videos before class so they can come to class prepared. I know this was a big thing in fall 2020. One of the biology, or was it A&P was doing for their labs? They were having them come before the lab so they could, as I would say, get to the good stuff. When I was teaching, a lot of people don't know, I was a music faculty before I went online ed. I wanted to talk about the good stuff. I wanted to teach the good stuff. I didn't want to teach the same lesson over and over. I wanted to have the good discussions. Number two, that's how we can free up your time. Videos add variety. Number three, they add variety to your lessons. So they can't replace the content, but they enhance the learning. Some people, videos, we've been teaching one way for a long time, and well, before books, they were teaching two, but books was an enhancement. Videos are an enhancement. It's not going to replace your course. It's not going to replace your books. It's not going to replace your handouts. It's going to enhance them. One of the big ways is number four, videos. It's how humans think and learn. Humans think in space and in time. And so a simple handout doesn't have the same engagement to the brain as a video. So you think about, balance a square, solve a quadratic equation, whatever. You can get that out on a handout, step by step. but a video shows the students through time. And that's how students, that's how young people learn. That's the psychology. You watch a process. It's not just the chunks of the steps. And for some people that might work, but again, it's an enhancement. And the videos cover oral, visual to some degree, kinesthetic, not literal kinesthetic, but as opposed to a handout, you see in somebody write out the equation, doing a lab simulation, that's far more than just reading through a simulation in a textbook. That kind of makes sense. So pseudo kinesthetic. Why should I use videos? Number five. Videos aren't bound to any time schedule. And it's kind of attracted to a little bit. Frees up your time. They can be utilized for teaching a concept for a class or for after class review. You don't have to wait for, oh, it's 8 o'clock. All right, now we're going to learn. You can have them come to class prepared. And I know, I mean, I was a teacher too. I get, oh, will they actually do it? Well, it's an assignment. If it's worth a grade, it's kind of like reading a book. Will they actually read it? Well, if you enforce it, they will. So I know that was, yeah, in kind of biology and the area, that was one of the fears. Will they come to the lab prepared and watching the video ahead of time? Well, they will if they if they have to, if their grades can suffer. So yes, you can utilize videos before your class, again, to get to the good stuff. And number six, videos are rewindable and reusable. Videos make lessons rewindable to students, and from the instructor perspective, they're reusable, which is great. You don't have to teach the same thing over and over and over, and the students missed a concept, they want to work through it again, they can go back after class, and they're good. I kind of mentioned before some of you guys got in here, this, if you feel free to interject at any time. I feel like we're all experts here. I've just organized my thoughts before I came. So feel free to jump in at any time if you want to add. Anybody have anything to add? Why do you guys like using videos before we go to the next slide? Yeah. It's early on Monday morning, I understand.
Okay. And if anybody's interested in that book, Michael Wesch mentioned, the author of that was Karen Costa, 99 Tips for Creating Simple and Sustainable Educational Videos. Simple and sustainable. And she uses that word a lot. So we've covered the why. Why are you here? You're obviously here because you're interested in this subject and you want to learn some more. Let's go to kind of the next section. What makes a good video lesson? What makes for a good video lesson? So I want to show another example. This here is from, hold on just a second. Make sure. Yeah. So this is a video that our own Greg Weiss here at HCC, he is the jazz instructor, the director of jazz studies here at HCC. So he built this for his online course. He takes a little bit different of approach than Michael Wesch's. And so I wanted to show you these. He created these this summer. He created, we're not going to watch the whole thing. All of them are pretty long for each unit of his jazz course. But we're going to watch maybe the first like 2 or 3 minutes of this video because he just does a great job and it's a different approach.
Welcome to Unit 9. When we talk about the 1950s in jazz, we're talking about a period where jazz splinters into many different styles. Simultaneously, it is one of the most important decades in jazz. Cool jazz was, in essence, started by the Miles Davis Nonet in 1949. It would have slower tempos than bebop. It would be more melodic and lyrical, and much more subtle in expression. The Miles Davis Nonet recorded the album Birth of the Cool in 1949 and 1950. It had an interesting instrumentation of trumpet, trombone, French horn, tuba, alto sax, barry sax, piano, bass, and drums. It was also the first collaboration between Miles and the arranger Gil Evans. here's one of the popular tracks called Botlicity. Notice how much of a stark contrast there is between this music and bebop music.
Greg, obviously he didn't make the cartoon part, but he made all of the point outs and all the lower thirds and all the presentation slide leading up to that, and a very different approach than what we looked at with Michael Wesch's. So that's where I want to transition to now, is kind of this next part. This is your first fork in the road of what kind of video you want to make. I mentioned earlier, are you going, is there going to put me in a box here and say there's only one way to make a video? No, not at all. But there are certain aspects of videos that make them more quality than others. So we have two, probably the biggest variety that you'll see in videos is there's an informal approach and a formal approach. The informal approach is more like what Michael Wesch did. Super simple is what Michael Wesch calls them. Simple and sustainable is what Karen Costa says from the book I pointed out. They have a more relaxed approach. They tend to be more personable. They're usually made to be reused, not made to be reusable each semester. They're more about approaching your students as their teacher here and now on a personable level. So these would be weekly announcements you might put out in an online class, or if it's a face-to-face class, it might just be, you can still put them out, weekly announcements, or you can build a discussion forum around them, or just as a way to connect to your students in an online class, kind of the same thing, but yeah, just using for, I mean, I don't know, the list goes on. I use it, announcements as an example because I think that's a really easy way to approach or start using videos in your online class. Weekly announcements, here's what's coming up. Think about this. Hey, I love that discussion post that Jamie said. Think about this. And what an amazing way to validate the students, pointing them out in the weekly announcements that they made a good point, or maybe even play a little devil's advocate, get them thinking about things. So the other approach is the formal video, and this is a little bit more, I'm sure you've seen the advertisements for Masterclass, and here's Malcolm Gladwell, where they take experts and they let them do these classes, and it's like $100 a year to get the gamut of their library. They're very formal. They're very formal. There's some informalness to them if you watch the whole series, but typically the approach is a lot more formal. They take a more professional look and feel. They tend to utilize a script or at least an outline and produce with minimal errors. You'd like to be able to use these from semester to semester, hopefully for years to come. I'm sure Greg, who created a formal video, is planning on using those for years to come. And you can share them amongst faculty as well. To accomplish their flexibility, they're usually less personable. They don't refer to the class, individual students. Don't, we had an instructor a few years ago, made a bunch of videos. He kept mentioning the section name and the year and had to redo them the next year because they seemed dated at that point. He could still use them, but it just didn't quite have that polished look to it. They focus primarily on the content.
So you can kind of see the contrast between Michael Lesh's video we watched first and then Greg's video, the difference between informal and formal. So, we're going to go a little bit more in depth about this approach. There are pros and cons to each, obviously. Connecting to students, your informal videos are going to put more of that you into your course. They're going to build more connections. Obviously, they're not reusable. You're probably going to have to do that every semester. So don't create real long ones. Create, you know, 2-3 minute, whatever, put an announcement, just say hi, check in with them. And encourage your students to do the same. Encourage your students to reply if it's your informal videos. So some of the stuff I wanted to point out, when you look at Greg's, he uses a really quality mic right in front of him. You know, it's not cringy to listen to. There's no pops, and he obviously did some mic checks. He dressed professionally. He's sitting at a desk in a neutral background. He obviously has a script or a bit of an outline. He knows what he's going to be talking about or kind of a lesson plan. And Greg added a lot of visuals to his. He obviously did a lot of work before and after, thinking about the lesson, creating the visuals, editing his video after the fact, so it had that polished look to it. Obviously, for simple and sustainable videos, you're not going to invest that much time. And the formal videos, they all obviously have better production quality. And yeah, I cover that. You put in a lot of work now, so it can be used for years to come. Greg's, I mean, it's an investment. Anybody like to add anything to informal? Has anybody used this kind of structure or thought about this structure before? Informal versus a formal approach, you feel like?
Well, maybe you're gonna cover it later, but I tried last year to take some, had my daughter help me take some videos of me instructing and different things. Mm-hmm. So by the time I got them on the learning zone, on the Canvas, and on the program with the videos, it had to dummy them down so much that the quality was horrible by the time I got it on learning zone.
Gotcha.
So I've ended up...
The visual quality or like...
Yeah, it's grainy. It's got to compress it to be on the system. So I ended up making an account on YouTube with my daughter. Now it's going to get a link to it with better quality. But it was the quality was so bad.
Did you use Studio?
Yes.
Oh, really? Okay.
By the time it converted, it was just you can see the you couldn't read the slideshow. It's so grainy.
Don't do so many.
You got close enough to read it, but now it's got a picture, which maybe was good. But I really like putting them on YouTube and just making a link to it and get a little better quality.
So Studio has no limit on size. I was one of Greg's, each one of Greg's videos like is about a gigabyte. So he was concerned about size. Studio, at least the first we've ever hit, there's no cap on it. Courses in Learning Zone do have caps, like half a gig. It's not much. So you can use Studio, put as many large files as you want, and it won't matter. And so with yours, it sounds like it was converted enough time. You're probably using several applications with different saving. By the time it got to Studio, you know, it had gone through enough compression that, it lost quality. So, definitely use Studio. Don't worry about file size unless it's just absolutely gigantic. But use Studio as much as you can because it also has, the software knows to increase or decrease your quality based on your bit rate, which could have been a thing too if you were on slow internet. It may have downgraded that too.
Did Derek he do his in Studio with both the webcam and then switching to the computer?
He used a software called HitFilm. It was one I was going to mention at the end. It's called HitFilm. It's free, and it is kind of right in the middle of. I haven't taken a look at it, other than just kind of perused it when Greg mentioned it to me. He said it's kind of in the middle between like a high, like professional quality one and something super simple. He's like, it's kind of in the middle, a little bit to learn it, but it's not too difficult. But it was called HitFilm.
So in Studio, can you switch? Because I know I've done a lot of Studio videos and some of them I've done like with the camera on me.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
And then some of them I've done where I've had something on the computer screen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But can you, in one video, can you switch back and forth between the two? Or
I don't know necessarily on Studio, but with most software programs, you can. I mean, even Zoom. With Zoom, you can even set up two cameras and have different angles even with their settings in it. So most software does. I don't know off the top of my head if Studio will allow that. My guess would be that it would, though, allow you to switch between, are you saying face-to-face and then desktop?
Yeah, so like if I start out and I want to them to see me, but then I have like a PowerPoint or something that I want to switch to.
It's been a while, but I'm almost certain that you can. I'm almost certain that you can. And I kind of explained earlier, we're not going to get too technical. I'm going to give some suggestions. If you guys have real technical questions, want to sit down with us, feel free to schedule time with any of us in online ed. We can kind of look at that, and not to discourage the questions, but we're not going to get too nitty gritty in the actual technical parts of creating the videos. But I believe that Studio can do that. If anybody knows for sure, feel free to jump in.
If I think a video I've edited with DaVinci Resolve, the Studio,
DaVinci Resolve is a great one. Yeah, that would be on kind of that higher level of difficulty, but that is one I will end up going to mention. But if you're comfortable, yeah, DaVinci Resolve, which is also free, which is great. And a lot, it's actually industry used. You have to pay for it if you're using it in the industry, but it's that high level of a software product. And yeah, that was one I was going to mention, DaVinci Resolve.
If you download it on your school computer, you'll have to have the IT people come through your permission.
Yep. Yeah. They're sticklers.
Okay, so that is the first fork in the road when you're thinking about what kind of videos that you're wanting to approach. Do you want to approach that as formal or informal? I actually, hand those around. I have this kind of a handout I threw together a few months ago on kind of the differences between these and just things to kind of consider as you're going through this first fork in the road, what you're going to do here. So I want to look at another approach with the Michael Wesch. I wanted to use a lot of good examples of videos that I liked in this. I think this is the last video I'm going to show you, though. So this is Michael Wesch. Now, we just talked a lot about formal videos and how Greg approached his. Michael Wesch here, he's going to talk about the informal approach, what he called super simple, what Karen Costa calls simple and sustainable. He talked about his approach and some of the pitfalls you might run into in making the informal videos. And I really want to encourage these informal videos because and I think Michael even points it out, they're a great place to start when you're doing videos because there's really no pressure. If you say or you stutter, whatever, you're going to, if you stumble on your words, it's fine. It's more of a natural approach.
Much rather be outside with bad lighting. And yeah, the image doesn't look as clean and it's not as beautiful as it was inside. But I much prefer this. It just makes me feel a lot more relaxed than talking out here than talking in there. So that's why I see so many of my little super simple videos are all just outside. So that brings me to the fifth point is the super simple video. It's definitely the way to start. I started out just going big. And the very first video I ever made for my students, I had this idea that I could go up on top of the biggest hill in town and go screaming down on my rollerblades, lecturing about the acceleration of cultural change. The next day, I was lecturing about human evolution. Again, I went big. I thought, okay, I'm going to show students that we were born to run long distances by running a marathon while I lecture about human evolution. That went okay, but I ended up getting this really nasty leg infection. I ended up in the hospital.
I'm going to get it.
It's very swollen if you compare it to. Just not good. And the funny thing is, when you talk to my students, you know, they thought those really grand videos were fine, but what they liked the most were these super simple ones.
What types of videos that Dr. West showed, either ones he made himself or, like you're saying, he curated a bunch, which did you find most engaging and which contributed most to your learning?
I think one in particular that I remember most is, it was really cool because he would directly address like specific students. So if I were to ask a question in the board, he would say, so Shyla asked this question, and then you would expand on it. And so that, like, took it to a different level of feeling like you were actually connecting in a classroom space.
So just keep it simple, keep it real, and just reach out and connect your students to help others.
So there is that idea of connections, and we're all, you know, my name's up in the doctor, and the doctor is your husband crazy? And we love it because humans think in these personal stories, and we think in time, and we think more than just handouts. And gosh, what amazing connections. And obviously, you can tell students love Dr. Wesch, and he, yeah, okay. I'll show you that, Dr. Wesch. There you go, Dr. Wesch. Yeah, I'm in love with the medical.
A real quick question for you. And if I'm recording a lecture in class and live with students, and camera's on me, but if a student asks a question, their voice is on there, there's no privacy issues with that, it's sort of putting on.
Say that again. What do you mean?
I'm in class, like I'm recording to you, mm-hmm. like I ask a question, so my voice is now on the audio on the video. I put that out there for a different class. Is that privacy?
Yeah, it's a FERPA deal. I mean, I'm not an expert on FERPA, anyone wants to chime in, but you're not supposed to ever refer to a student. Students outside of the class they're in are not supposed to easily know what the schedules of other students are. So yeah, when I was teaching music, I couldn't put my private lesson schedule on door because other students could see, oh, Jamie plays trombone. I don't know, like some really weird music. I don't know, but okay, you know, maybe you don't want people knowing you're taking trombone lessons. That's fine. So yeah, that would be something you need to be careful with if you're going to be pointing out that student maybe so.
But if it's just their voice and you
just their
call
voice.
Them by name or anything,
I think
wouldn't be a problem.
I wouldn't think so. Again, I'm not an expert on verba, but I would. Issue at all. Yeah, okay. Yeah, identifiable. That's a good, it's not identifiable. So, yeah, I wouldn't worry about that. Yeah, I thought if you directly addressed them by name.
Yeah, that's be careful not calling their name, I think.
Yeah. No, that's a very good question. So, we've seeing a couple different approaches to quality lessons here, an informal approach and a formal approach. So this gets into the what makes quality video lessons. Sure, a lesson is a lesson. Yeah, but the quality of the video and the lesson can vary immensely. So what sets them apart? One of the biggest ones we'll push, and pretty much everybody pushes everywhere that I research, is time. Keep your videos, we always suggest under 4 minutes. I've heard under 5 minutes. I've also seen under 6 minutes. But research has shown at 6 minutes, there's definitely a drop off in attention. Like, definitely. And, you know, we want to laugh at that, you know, oh, it's just students. I mean, come on, it's all of us, right? Like, if I'm watching a YouTube video, I want to watch something. Okay, gosh, let's get to the point. Right? So, keep your video short. That is my only criticism of Greg's videos. He took a kind of a lecture approach, 1 hour, kind of like if you were in his class. I highly suggest breaking your videos up. If you want to cover, like Greg did, an hour long, you want to cover the whole unit, break it up into smaller chunks. I mean, you're building out your lessons, you've probably broken them into chunks, break them into smaller chunks, because that's students are going to want to know what the topic is and cover just that. Just like when I get on YouTube and I want to learn how to do something, I want to learn how to, you know, I don't know, blur my edges in Photoshop or something. I don't want to watch an hour of a video on it. Just not to the point. So not saying the other 55 minutes of the video is not good. It's just break it up. That's why it looks like chapters, right? So break it up. So time. I can keep them under 4 minutes. 6 minutes is definitely pushing it. Pick a simple concept and stay on topic. That's kind of the same idea, but kind of that chapter's idea. Don't be a Derek and ramble and get sidetracked and tangented, because I know I do at work and at home. Stay on topic. Stay on your main point that you're trying to focus on. If you have 2 points that you want to make, can break it up into different phases so your students can jump in. And that's another thing. They can jump in and jump out. If they see an hour-long video, I don't have an hour. Well, they have 5 minutes here and there. They can watch them. Oh, that's right. I watched lesson 9. I'm ready for lesson 10 now. Just break them up. It's 5 minutes. That's absolutely fine. Number 3 is be authentic, professional, but casual. That's okay. You don't have to wear a suit and tie. You don't have to have high production quality, especially with an informal one. But with formal ones, you don't have to be super rigid. You don't have to literally read off of a script. Keep it casual. Again, we're trying to build some connections here. Number 4, if you're especially for formal videos, symbols and visual aids, do not overuse text. Honestly, I feel like I use way more text than I usually do on this presentation. I don't know why, I just was feeling worried. But you'll notice in Greg's video, he uses a lot of bullet points. He used a lot of little lower thirds to pop up. Hey, this is Jerry Mulligan's Barry Sax solo. Here's the head of the song. Here's, you know, just little visual aids to help pop out, because it doesn't, especially if you're using your voice, you really don't need to be reading off the text on because I even get embarrassed up here reading text to you. You guys can read. So don't overuse text. Usage of symbols and visual aids. Very important. And then number 5, and we're going to get a little bit more into this next, but check your sound and mic settings. It can be a put off when you're listening and it just sounds, you know, you hear that kind of white noise, you hear the mic pop, you hear the, do a quick sound check. And again, if you want some kind of help on how to kind of work some of those settings, come in online and we can help you, you know, make sure that the settings on whatever software you're using, how to kind of adjust the input into your mics and stuff like that. There was one other thing I was gonna say about formal videos. What was it? I just don't do that part. I have a couple other tips, though, for videos. Feel free to check their understanding, especially videos. They're not bound to time. Students can pause it. You can say, hey, I'm going to solve this problem. Go ahead, stop, think about this, solve it, work on your own. Pause the video. I'll be back whenever you're ready. So it's a really great use for that. And then also for... something really important I was going to say about formal videos. It'll come back. One other tip I wanted to mention was when you're creating a video, don't be afraid to keep your first and last sentences just kind of a standard boilerplate template. I really like using, in this video, blah, 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 or welcome to the blah, blah, blah class. Today we're going to talk about I used to spend way too much time thinking about how I'm going to start this video and how I'm going to end it. I mean, seriously, it was like, what should I start? It's okay. Just use the same. If you want to use the same sentence, the same template, welcome to whatever in this lesson we're going to, blah, blah, blah. Or ending it, well, that wraps it up for the blah, blah, blah lesson. See you in the next video. Or my personal favorite, just end it like a news anchor's cadence. Click the save button. You're good to go. End it. You can end a video like that. You don't have to, you know, say goodbye and shake their hands and stuff. That took me a long time to learn. I can just close my mouth. Wow. That's a concept for me. I'm working on it.
I have a question on the time.
Yeah.
If I have a video, so like during COVID, I had a guest speaker that I recorded on Zoom, mm-hmm. and he no longer comes because he doesn't have the same position he used to have. So I have that video to show my mm-hmm. class. So I can go ahead and break that up into chunks.
If you want to, it's not.
And then if I did break it into chunks, is there a way, like when the one video ends, that there's something like that they immediately see that says click here for the next video so that they could watch it going back into
not necessarily very smoothly. The 5 minute rule isn't, I mean, it's not set in stone. It's kind of something that needs to be thought of before the lessons presentations are made. So somebody did an hour and a half long lecture. I mean, you're not going to break it up. And I was kind of thinking about that this morning. I mean, if you have, and Greg, who just got his PhD, if you're working with like PhD level students, some of those concepts are 1 hour, 2 hour long concepts. Like they just are. So it's not a steadfast rule to break, you know, but especially when you're working with concepts, fundamental knowledge type lessons, definitely. But if it's just a presentation or a discussion or a doc, if there's no real good way, I mean, if he takes an intermission, feel free to break.
I did do a little video that said, please note this is a 45-minute video,
yeah.
So allow 45 minutes, when you sit down, or be willing to pause it and come back to it later.
And that's
so the students were aware that it's going to take 45 minutes to watch this.
Yes, that is. I think that's a good tip. If you have a long video, to mention that to them. I don't know how many people got to the last episode of Stranger Things and looked at the clock. And I was like, it's 11:30. There's still an hour of this episode left. They made this episode 2 hours long. I need to go to bed. I just kept watching it because I didn't know how much time I needed to dedicate to this. So I think that's a good point to say if you have a longer video. But okay. So let's, anybody else have anything to interject before we kind of go on to kind of the last part, which is just a little more technical. I'm not going to say it's super technical. And I was hoping to finish just a little early so we have maybe 10 minutes to just kind of talk and discuss. How this was under kind of the subheader of so what now? Where do I start? How do I actually create a good video lesson? Well, I'm not going to get into pedagogy and lesson plans. You guys are all teachers, you know that. But I will point out a few just kind of tips to think about before you guys get going. Where to start? What to consider? We've already talked about the informal, informal. Think about that. Will you be wanting to reuse this lesson semester, multiple classes? What am I going to say? And this is a very, very big one that I can't stress enough, is having at least an outline. I'm a fan of an outline. Tracy in Online Ed is more of a fan of a script. She feels more comfortable with that. I feel less comfortable with a line-by-line script. I like an outline. That's how I'm going to make my lesson plans. You will lose quality very quickly if you didn't kind of think about what you were going to say, even for an informal video. Just think about the main points that you want to make, the main topics that you want to cover. Rambling will and going on tangents, avoid it at all costs, because just try and stay on topic. Not to say you can't do personal anecdotes. Everyone loves a good story, a little attention getter. But just try not to cover more than one or two concepts. Don't try and get totally lost about, the history of this symbol here or whatever, just because you found it interesting. Maybe you can make another video about that and put that in. And then lastly, think about sound, visuals, and setting. These are just things that we've seen kind of in online ed, figuring out what sets some videos apart. Think about your setting at your desk. Maybe you're going to do a screen capture. Maybe you're going to do a lab simulation. But think about that. We've seen people that want to do this mixed thing where they want to kind of do it in a formal video, but they want to do it in their backyard without a script, and you can hear the dogs barking. You can hear it, but they're presenting themselves as this is a formal thing. Well, if you're going to make it formal, think about giving yourself a formal setting. If it's informal, still think about traffic noise or anything like that. People barging in on you, whatever. But think about the setting. We like to suggest a neutral background, bookshelves are always good. Just anything sitting at your desk, that's always a good background, good go-to for almost anything. Mic and sound check, we already talked about that. Think about lighting. That's a big deal. Think about if you want, you can get those cheap ring lights you know, they're like $5, $10, you get like the $50 big ones. They do. They surprisingly add a lot of quality. That Michael Wesch video, if you want to find it, watch the whole thing. He kind of talks about some of this. He talks about like just buying a simple lapel mic and like a $10, you know, white ring will up the quality of your audio. Spend $15, and I mean the audio and the video will really up it. You don't have to be super expensive with it. Even when he started out, he would stand in his sunroom and duct tape his phone to his windows so he'd get that sunlight facing him, and he just hit play on his phone camera. And phones are fine. Phones are absolutely fine. And I was going to mention the kind of hardware that you might need. Phones today are, I mean, honestly, the audio and visual is typically better. Well, it's definitely going to be better than any like laptop, built-in microphone, built-in camera. Usually our phones are even better than most like webcams will buy. Get great, great sound. But if you're going to use a phone, I would suggest like a Bluetooth lapel mic. Get them, you know, like $10 on Amazon. Like seriously, like you would be very surprised at the difference in the quality, especially if you're going to be outside. Well, no, it doesn't really matter. Even if you're inside, it'll take that kind of echo and reverb out of your voice and just makes it easier to listen to. Some of the software that we use. So in our office, obviously we use Studio. We talk about Studio. Is everyone familiar with Studio? We throw that word out a lot. Anybody? Okay, built in Canvas. When the pandemic hit, they added a lot of features to not just host videos, but actually edit the videos, record the videos right from the browser. Very cool. We also use an online Camtasia, Camtasia by TechSmith. So that is, I didn't realize how dark this, or how hard that is to see up here. It's a little bit to the back. Camtasia is spelled C-A-M-T-A-S-I-A. The college has licenses for it. I don't know how many. We used to have a bunch. I think we've given them all out. I know Jillian's area, she used to hand some out to people. I don't know. So check with your department chairs to see if your department has license for Camtasia. Otherwise, it's like $70, I think. And it's kind of a middle of the road. It's not... doesn't have a huge learning curve, but you will have to learn it a little bit. But it's easy to use and really good, very, very good video editor.
Derek, I'll say that 45 minute video I was able to, I used Camtasia to take that from a 90 minute presentation to 45 minutes just getting, I took out all the long pauses and all the and all of that stuff. And then the beginning in production, like when I introduced him and like all this stuff that wasn't necessary, just so the students got the 45 minutes of content.
Get right to the good stuff. Absolutely. Yeah. So you use Camtasia and you find it, the learning curve wasn't too bad.
Yeah, it wouldn't be bad if I use it every semester, but
that's kind of where I'm at.
You know, every time I go to use it, I kind of have to like refresh my memory on how.
I'm the same way. We'll put out new kind of video tutorials, once a year or so, and you kind of go, wow, how did I cut the videos? But it's not too bad. It is fairly intuitive. If you want to go on the high end Adobe Premiere, that's going to cost you money. So if you're not already kind of into video editing, I think the college does have licenses for everyone for Adobe. I don't know. We have Adobe in our area, so I don't know if everyone gets that. But Adobe Premiere is an industry standard. I mean, that's a very good one. We already talked about DaVinci Resolve, which is also industry standard, but it's free. And then great use Hit Film. HITFIL. So that kind of wraps up pretty much what I wanted to kind of cover, but I wanted to give you guys a chance to talk or share your ideas with the group if you want, if you have to. But has anybody used informal videos in their courses? Weekly announcements? Hold on, I have a handout I wanted to give you guys too.
Terry, did you have something?
Yeah, I did a GPP announcement in my online class last spring.
Uh-huh.
And I really liked it. I don't know if the students. I don't know how many. Can you go in and see how many students are watching them?
If you use Studio, you can see who uses them. Yeah, if you use Studio, but if you embed it right into the announcement, I don't think you can actually see who's viewed the announcement or that video. But if you use Studio, you can see. And again, attach the little, I don't know, when I was teaching, I was like, hey, you guys got to know your music eras. We're gonna have a quiz. It'll be really short, be like a 2-minute quiz, but you better know the things. So attaching something that doesn't have to be a huge essay, just a little bit of like 5 points.
I would just watch it. Like, this is what you're doing, this is what the assignments you'll be doing. Okay, by the way, I noticed a lot of you had questions about XYZ last week. Here's a little wrap up, but I kept them at about 5 minutes. Yeah.
No, I think that's absolutely great. I think it's wonderful. And you can point out things to look for, mistakes you've seen in the past, you really might want to reread, and just like that. Yeah, absolutely. A great place to start, here's this handout on doing it. So this is specifically for online courses, the handout that I just handed out. For doing like a course preview, this came out when I'm working on retention rates a few years ago, trying to get better retention rate in our online courses. And this approach was kind of suggested, and unfortunately I never really took on, but a lot of people seem excited about it. Yeah, I mean, I thought about it, but it seemed kind of tough. But I thought, well, what if I just kind of create like a little script, a little outline template? Did everyone get the handout? Yeah, so basically this is for an online course for like start of the semester. So online courses start on Monday. Consider maybe this week creating a short little like 4-minute video that kind of follows this little template here. And basically it's just an overview of the course. Hey, here's the modules page. Here's the get started page. You're going to have a midterm. You're going to have a final project. Every unit is going to be the same. You're going to click here, read this stuff, and then you're going to have a quiz, discussion, and an essay, you know, whatever. It's just kind of a quick overview. Maybe mention anything that has hung people up in the past. A lot of people forget to start working on the research projects, you know, on week 12. Start then. Just give them a heads up of what this course is going to look like. We know a lot of students that don't know that there are modules in the course until like 2 or 3 weeks in, because they just were going off their to-do list. Well, if you send them a video in their inbox or announcements and they get their notification, maybe that'll help get them started on the right foot. So this is just a little script, take it or leave it, or feel free to edit it or change it. This is just how I approach it. So obviously, I think it's perfect, but again, you want to keep it personal. You want to be authentic. So feel free to take that direction. Anybody else? Yeah, Terry.
Quick question. How do you take an informal video from your cell phone and get it into Studio?
So, yeah, there's a few approaches. I mean, one, so just using your USB. And do you have Apple or do you have an iPhone or Android?
iPhone.
Okay. Not as familiar with iPhones, but I believe it's pretty easy to drag. Well, who has iPhones, please? Somebody's got to have. Jesse, you have computers.
Okay.
Okay. Well, how do you drag a file from your iPhone to your
Is it? It's impossible.
Oh.
Yeah.
So forget it, Terry.
There's too much security involved with the iPhone to be able to do something like that. So it's you got to email it. I think you can use the Canvas app.
That's what I was just going to say. That was going to be my next suggestion. I don't have an iPhone, but I would assume that with Android, the Canvas app will open up your recent videos, and you should be able to put it in that. Have you had trouble with that before, Terry?
I have not. All the Canvas or all the Studio videos I've done have been in front of my computer.
Okay.
So I've never tried doing it.
Stop by. That's how we learned too. in our office. So, yeah, please stop by. I'm sure we can figure it out or find out if it is, in fact, impossible.
Okay.
But no, I think one way or another, we can do that.
Is Studio and the Canvas app
As far as I know.
Would you be able to just pull up the Canvas app and go in the studio and then just record it?
That's what I'm thinking.
I think so, yeah.
I have it on here right now, but I don't see a record. It links to all of my current ones that I've already made.
But if you pre-record it, will it see?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So that seems like maybe probably the easier way to do it is go ahead and pre-record it with your video recording app.
You can upload
and then
upload back to Google and then log into Google and save as a video. Works pretty well.
So a lot of ways we could do it. Depends. You use your Google Drive a lot. That could be, you know, it just kind of depends. But that's what we're here for. Again, that's, you know, our email, phone number, in our office, most of you know where we're at, right across the hall from Dr. Vile. Anything else? Any other questions? Any ideas? Anything?
I'm thinking of all those emails that I get that are the same every semester. I'm going to be gone. Will I miss anything important? To make a video that says, yes, you will miss something important. You can find that information in Learning Zone. And then just refer them to the video. And like I was thinking doing a frequently asked questions module and putting up videos in there.
Oh, I think that's great. Yeah.
And so then when they email, I'll just say, yes, you did go to the frequently asked questions videos. You'll find one that will answer this question.
That's how a lot of our bridge trainings start. We go, we're answering this question a lot. we can just make a video of this and save ourselves.
Save yourself some time.
That is efficiency, which I'm very obsessed with. Efficiency and getting to the good part. Gosh, getting to the good part of your lessons and having your students come in prepared. I don't know if you guys have heard the flipped classroom. That's like this big term. Everyone talks about the flipped classroom. It means the students learn before they come to class so they can do stuff. I always feel like, well, isn't that just kind of how it should be? I mean, students should be. And this makes it super easy, right? So you can work with your students. If they come to class prepared, if you've done a lesson, or at least like the kind of bulk of kind of the fundamental of the concepts, they can come to class and you can work with them. You can actually just sit down and I guess I get to the good stuff. And once again, also if you're working more one-on-one with students or smaller groups, connections, building connections and digging deeper. Anything else? Thanks for coming, guys. This was fun. And feel free to stop by our office. Say hello. Max likes to bring us chocolate. It doesn't hurt.